Okay.
So
I'm gonna turn off the lights again, I think, for making it easier to see in the run. I'll leave the back on unless you guys find it stops you from seeing. So in the morning today, we're gonna talk about a number of different things that all relate to how you actually analyze your data. We spent most of yesterday talking about how you process and how you run one place, and how you determine if you did those things correctly. This morning we're going to talk about what you do after you remove noise. So essentially the second stage of the pipeline. And there's a number of things that will come up here in how you organize and store your information, and how we identify different analysis techniques for different types of experiments. And we'll kind of stop probably just after the survival analysis component, move into a practical session, and again, as we did yesterday, get you guys to start working with what we've described, and that will involve some statistical testing analysis, and then we'll come back into the net analysis and machine learning sections. So, let me start off with something that I think several of you have started to consider. What happens if you have your own experiment? What we're dealing with here are small experiments. The secondary data, which should not be kept in the dark, is things like your normalized QA/QC, all that stuff that you want to show to the reviewers. And a dump of all your raw normalized data, that's a standard for uploading to public repositories to show people what you've got and allow them to download that and trust your data if they wish to. And then downstream of that are your tertiary analyses. So there are things like your statistical analysis, downstream pathway or integration studies that you may wish to do. And so these are separate things that you have to keep straight in your head, but they're all things that you've got to keep being able to trace through and know where they're going to go. And in a standard study, you're going to have quite a lot of these. So for a clinical study, you can keep tens of gigabytes of files. So nothing like a sequencing study, but still fairly large in there too. Institutional drive. There's a nice trick over here with these two things. they need to be uploaded to a public repository or publication. There's nothing that says that you can't upload them now. So for a lot of our studies, upload all of our downstream, but actually everything downstream is more just computer time and having your scripts to be available. So I recommend that you put everything on a fast backup network drive. And the way that we would organize things on my team is by project. So I might have an underlying folder called data, and then each project would get its own directory. So for example, we have a CDW main exercise and CDW integrated analysis with two separate that in one place, so I don't have to go through, which file is this? It's all there, easy to find. I would want my pre-processed data in a single location, just the pre-processed data. That is the file that is going to become really useful for you when you decide to integrate with public data sets or a pathway analysis. And I have a separate directory for the statistical analysis, where I'm going to include the U-test output and the T-test output. Find things, quick to transfer things to collaborators, and also means that when you've got dozens of projects at some point in time, you'll easily be able to trace through all of those. I also recommend that you put scripts in a separate location. I described how your data should go in /data/project. I suggest that your scripts go in /script/project. There's a couple of reasons for this. One is that separating your data to be sort of generic and independent, and you want it to be in a separate place so that you can always find it. In fact, imagine somebody deletes your data directory. If you're lucky, you can go to Geo and re-download all of your experiments and reprocess them. As long as you've got your scripts, you're okay. In fact, you might only need to back this up in Drupal, because if everything else is available on a website somewhere, so the idea would be that there are scripts, projects, and then for each project, we have one script for one type of analysis, one for pre-processing, one for univariate statistical analysis, multivariate statistical analysis. If we have things that go outside into what we might call tertiary methods, then we have a pathway section for different types of pathway or different types of integration analysis, and so we provide some separation. You might get something like 10, 15 scripts. By contrast, you'll get hundreds of data files. So there's a reason why we think it's very important to have a lot of subdirectories as part of your gear. You just need good file names. In fact, you'll see that we use kind of the same file naming structure in my lab for everything. So there's lots of projects that will have had it in Nome, that is exactly what that file is going to do. But as you only work on two or three projects, make sure that the names that you give files are clear and simple. It goes without saying that when you look at this again a year later, you're going to sort of forget exactly what you did and why. One thing that I did there, and I'm going to be able to... Everybody would use, but they piece them together in ways that are specific for our analysis. And so, in that sense, we think of the piece unit being the bioconductor libraries, and those provide us the tools that we fit together for our own studies. The question, though, is interesting because it makes you ask, so what if we were here to ask you for your scripts? How do you provide them? What do you do with it? And it's becoming increasingly desired to upload scripts. But also not a no-name journal by any means. So those kinds of things happen surprisingly often. And as we are increasingly forced to have our code in the publication, it makes it important that we structure it internally well. I try to think of things as much as possible that when we write it, I want it to be something that I can dump as supplementary material on the journal's website right away. We have these small scripts, one that we do pre-processing, one that we do univariate statistical analysis. That's not actually the way we've been working here so far. I've simplified things here to put them all in one large script. Really, we like to separate things for a couple of reasons. One, as you start to see, your large scripts are getting hard to maintain. They're large, they're long, and by the time we're done in this, sometime before for some other reason. That is a classic source of errors where somebody will say x equals 3 and then later they'll go x equals 5 and they'll forget that x was supposed to be 3 before. And those kind of things where you reuse a name leads to a lot of problems. So we try to make everything with long names that are easily clear that you will be able to understand if you go back to this a year ago. It's also hard to find bugs. Imagine that your script looks like it's good. Is this causing an error because of a syntax, or is it something logical? And where did that logic come from the script? Instead, it makes sense for you to have a smaller thing that you can easily identify errors in. And lastly, one day, you may not be looking at your own code. Long time ago, I was the only person looking at my code, and then I started my lab, and I thought the great thing that I would do would be to take all the code that I running rerun. So imagine that I changed my statistical model from a univariate to a multivariate. If I've done it correctly, I don't have to rerun my QA, QC, and all of those other things. I can just rerun that statistical analysis. And it also gets at what you just asked about, can I reuse the code in another data set? And I might be able to take the same script and use it at least as a template for that, even if it needs some changes. So in a lot of ways, what I'm describing is a good software engineer. And it's a little bit like the way Unix is designed, where you have very small functions that you piece together in complex ways. Not on the array, or because it's not statistically significant. That's a good question. And a trivial one to answer if you have a table of all genes in this code. Search for this gene, it's not there, or it is. I do usually collapse all of my statistical analysis into one file. I'll have one file, each row is a gene, and I'll put t-test and u-test and multivariate and all of those results together in one easily searchable place. That makes your life easier for questions like that. I will point this out, your raw data is going to be much larger than all of the stuff that we're talking about saving. So this isn't really a disk space consideration. The biggest thing that you have to do is just make sure that your columns are always about what you're looking at and not going to be related to the data that you generated. A couple of key points here. Files by name. So the name is the first part of every output file. So imagine that we do an analysis today. The analysis will say 2013 row 6 25. And tell us that that's the starting point that we do everything. That allows us to easily keep different versions of our analysis. And let's just go back to things that we did in the past. The other thing is, I strongly encourage that you pass off all backup work to professional sysadmins. If you cannot, then you need to have weekly backups of all of your scripts at least. Our drives are okay. Our scripts we back up to a couple of different locations. You might think about something like a Google Drive or a Dropbox or something like that where you can store that. That is the core thing you do not want. So let's talk about statistics. So we spend a lot of time yesterday talking about experimental design and testing new tests. And those encompass a large fraction of the actual stuff that we see in data analysis. But there's a lot of other interesting cases, and those can ask questions that are particularly logically relevant. Imagine that we have an equation of this form, where this y variable is a factor. That would be a logistic regression, either a multiple or a single regression. So, for example, turns out to be an equation that looks like this. Some conditions on one of the variables. If x is a factor, now we have a one-way analog. If x1 and x2 are both real-level factors, now we have two analogs. If something here we're pointing out. One way to know that on large amounts. Imagine doing a one-way ANOVA. Simple. Simplifying your models a little bit. Saying, to have the maximally non-correlation. Thank you. Although that might be a good can't imagine. Continuous variables. For example, we might have some that are not precisely defined, like groups that are performance on a test or sensitivity to a specific compound. So we can build numbers that are on a continuous scale. So imagine here we have six cell lines with different sensitivity to the drug. We want to know which groups are associated. Using continuous variables. Alternatively, we can use correlation metrics. Correlation metrics can be more powerful than analysis. The model would be very simple. It would be y equals a naught a1x1. Y is your mRNA abundance, a naught is the level and absence of the drug, and a1x1 is the effect of the drug. How much the drug is affecting the expression of a given gene based on a set of sensitivities. Correlation. Correlation of 0.3 something. The range is absolutely independent of the sample size. I have a million people that have a range of minus 1 to 1, or we have people that have a solid range of minus 1 to 1. And it's independent of the ranges of the variables that I'm looking at. Something that provides a way to compare things across a very basically three types of relationships. Correlations can be positive when one variable goes up, the other one tends to. Negative when one goes down, the other one goes up. And no relationship. And just in case this ever comes up, this is worth noting. Variables are independent. We talk about independent variables over and over. Correlation is zero, covariance is zero. Some examples of what this might be like. Pearson's correlation is defined as the covariance of two variables scaled by their standard deviations. And essentially, it looks like what you might expect. Straight line gives you a correlation of 1, and then that gives you a cloud of data points, you get a correlation of 0, and the straight line is looking other ways telling you anything about the slope. Very acute. Telling you about the relationship. Such a weak spot. Nonlinear relationships directly. Zero, but you have this description of the relationship. But the other common correlation is no assumptions about the relationships or the structure of the relationships between the variables. The difference between the rate. Standard metrics available in our I'll show you that very quickly now because that's interesting. So imagine that I pull up an R session at a So imagine that I have a variable x that is 1 to 10 and y that is 10 to 1. And so I want to do the correlation between them. The function in R that we used yesterday is core, and it gives me a perfect negative correlation. And if I want to take a look at the help for core, I type question mark, and it'll allow me to use different methods. So I can do core XY method equals experiment, and it will also give me a correlation of minus 1. There's a beautiful function called core.test. Will allow me to not only generate a correlation of minus 1, but also a p-value. And shockingly, perfectly inversely correlated numbers are highly statistically significant. And this will allow you to generate a p-value for your correlations. It's telling you if this is significantly different from 1. Okay. And let's quickly talk about a couple of other topics in statistical analysis. So, two others. One, survival analysis. And it's something that is very, very common now. It's growing in a pop. Let me ask. I noticed some people are getting a bit tired. Do people want a coffee break now? Hands up if you want a coffee break now. Nobody? All right. So, we've got about another 15, 20 minutes. And I'm totally fine. So, survival analysis. It's something that is of growing importance. And if you take a look at Lancet or New England, to patients by the end of the study. So, you might study the outcome of some sort of childhood cancer and whether a new treatment increases how long people live. The problem is we can't wait 60 years until every clinical just know that they are alive for a certain length of time. So, for example, you might have individuals that are alive for 3 years, and then we stop following them up because they moved to another city or they went to a different place. We don't know their final outcome. That patient might die, but they haven't yet. So that would be a good example of censoring of the data. So there are standard statistical approaches for dealing with censored data, and they're not particularly challenging to implement. You could use something that looks like this, a survival curve. And the survival curve contains a couple of pieces of information that you'll want to know. The hazard ratio, telling you the difference in outcome between the two groups. But its hazard ratio says that the patients in the blue group have about 2 times better outcome than the patients in the red group. And the key value is the probability that the hazard ratio is not 1. There are other statistical tests you can use for this, like the log rank test. Classic microarray study in Michigan studied non-small cell lung cancer patients on an older Affymetrix microarray. Did two different things. One is they took a look at 12 normal samples and asked what genes were different between normal and tumor. And then those are the genes that probably initiate a tumor. They then took the 10,000 genes and compared their association with survival. So they did exactly as we've discussed, 13 t-tests for the initiation question, and found hundreds of genes that were different, including many more genes that were turned down and turned off, so, suggesting that there are more tumor suppressors than all the genes. They ran Cox models on each gene and identified hundreds of genes that were associated with the progression. Associated with initiation, suggesting that it's a much more evolutionarily complicated thing for a tumor to evade therapy and survive than it is for it to just grow in the first place. So, example of some very complicated things you got using exactly the techniques that we talked about. Nothing particularly unusual. You can imagine they normalized the data, reprocessed it, ran a Cox model for each gene, and a t-test for each gene. Options about a Cox model. First of all, they are semi-parametric, and that means that they have a lot of interesting assumptions about the way that the baseline hazard has to be. And the censoring has to be independent. So, for example, imagine you're studying toxicology, and you think that patients are going to drop out of your study if they have an adverse outcome to what you're giving them. Then all of their assumptions are broken. And in fact, I'll go so far as you probably don't want to do a survival. Opportunity to do it, and people are a statistician. These are actually quite tricky. And on my team, we have 2 or 3 statisticians who are experts on this type of analysis, have masters in survival analysis, and they provide kind of the core body of expertise to make sure that the rest of us don't mess it up. So this is something that's actually quite tricky. Similarly, in the level of trickiness with meta analysis, we talked about the challenges in merging multiple micro studies. Merge data from multiple studies with different data profiles. There are clear advantages to this. The first is that if you do a meta-analysis, you can identify some publication bias. You can find out that there's actually really interesting data out there that people just aren't publishing. You can also figure out appropriate ways to apply to different studies. So you can say, wait, how much should I trust different studies? And you can say, this study is a real outlier, and maybe I shouldn't be trusting it too much. Of course, you can use this through statistical power, and you've got the advantage of having much more interpretation of the results. Instead of giving somebody the results from 5 separate studies and saying, here are 5 different p-values, you can say, here's 1 p-value from 1 study and 1 conclusion. And So if you're trying to give clinical guidance, meta analysis is the way to go. And then the standard way to do this, the Cochrane guidelines to meta analysis. One is independent study. So if you want to do a meta analysis, you have to trust that the original studies are designed right. So an easy example is what happens if you threw away half of their data. Match their hypothesis, they'll have no idea. Secondly, you'll identify the fact that there is publication bias, but you can't do anything to control for it. You can just say, okay, it's there. We know it's there, it's going to affect our results, but you won't know exactly how much or what the consequences are. And lastly, there's a real challenge in doing that analysis based on the heterogeneity of the data, something called Simpson's paradox. Database. Thank you. noticed that So we're back at 11.